Subject area that I think is so vitally important, of course, everything I preach I think is vitally important, but I really feel it's from the heart of the Lord, and it has to do with living in victory over the powers of the enemy. Now, we've over the last couple of weeks dealt with the aspects of the spiritual war that are set kind of the foundations, and I'm going to review those, but before we do that, let's pray. Father, bless your word today. We thank you, God, that you've given us your word so we understand how the kingdom of God works. We also understand all that's been given to us, the blessings that have come by your grace to us, that how we might live in victory over all the schemes and the plans of the enemy, and Lord, that we can walk in that victory. So in Jesus' name, we bind every power of the enemy that would intervene and that would affect those that are in this place and receive truth this day. We bind it and say in Jesus' name, loose your hold right now. Jesus' name. Thank you for your word, Lord. Amen. So we're going to be talking about curses, and you have several things in your possession. One is this message for today, conquering curses. The other one, which I gave out last week, was breaking curses through the blood of the Lamb. And we'll see how much time we have for that. Probably not enough time to cover that thoroughly, but that's something to take with you and study this one right here. I'll make some comments on it, and I've talked to you about that in the past. And all of this, all what we're studying here is really predicated on, ultimately, on you doing it. I think there's a lot of folks who are in churches that they have doctrine, they have knowledge. He said, if you know these things, Jesus said, if you know these things, blessed are you if you actually do them. And there, I think there's a gap between the knowing and the doing. You know, somebody said you have to be a human being before you're a human doing. But in other words, you've got to get something into your spirit and know something. You've got to, before you can do it, you've got to know it. But just knowing it will not get you the victory. So I want to encourage you to take these things and actually apply them to your life. I've tested them for years, and they just work. Whether it's in reference to your physical body and your physical health, whether it's in reference to your relationships, whether it's in reference to your material life and your, you know, where you live and how things unfold in your life, they just work. And I've tested them for years. I've been doing this, being saved and understanding these principles for over 30 years. And the other is this, that just because you do all of these things doesn't mean that everything in your life is going to be perfect. You know, that's not true either. There will be challenges in your life and things will happen in your life. But every one of those, if God allows it, if you're applying these principles and something comes into your life and there's some tribulation, there's a struggle in your life, that's just an opportunity for you to grow. See, a lot of times when something comes into our life, a testing and a trial, we get all upset and say, well, you know, this is a bad thing, or this test has come, and we look at, we magnify the difficulties, we magnify the problem, and rather than saying, looking at it in a positive way, saying, this is an opportunity for me to grow. This is a place where my faith can now grow. Now, it's also a time to assess where our life is, because some things happen in our life, they should have never happened, and we've been neglectful in some area of our life. I've always found this in counseling and in ministry, is that everybody who comes in, their problem oftentimes, some of it just happens spontaneously and God is working in it and it's happening and through it you're going to grow. But oftentimes, not all the time, but oftentimes people find themselves in their struggle, in their dilemma, simply because they've been neglectful. They've just been neglectful. Why does a marriage fall apart ultimately? That's not God's will for the marriage to disintegrate and fall apart. Why does that happen? Everybody say neglect. It's neglecting a principle of the kingdom. So that's a key. It's neglect. So I'm going to give you the principles, the keys that I know. And if you apply them consistently over time, you'll see victory come in your life. And you just won't buy into and say, well, this kind of happens to everybody. And sick, you know, people are always sick and people getting sick. And you buy into that. And you're not applying these principles, then you will live according to that belief system. So remember, Jesus said, be it done unto you according to your faith. Now, if you have negative faith, which is kind of called unbelief, but if you believe a negative, That's how the enemy works in your life. One of the schemes is, and it's called a stronghold, if the devil can get you to believe something as true that's absolutely not true, that's what you're going to succumb to. One of the things I've mentioned over time, when people say, you ask a person who doesn't know too much about this, and they'll ask him, about death or dying, and they'll say, well, I'm going to die from something. I'm some sickness. I'm going to die from cancer, or I'm going to die from heart disease, or I'm going to die from this, that, and the other thing. That's their faith. In other words, if that's what you believe, that belief comes in. When you believe that will unfold your future. That's what will unfold in your life, based upon what Jesus said. He said, be it done unto you according to your faith. Now, but when we see that what Jesus has purchased for us is divine healing. But he's also purchased something beyond that, which is divine health. Now, and I've said to you many times, I don't understand every bit of dynamics of this, because we know the struggle with sickness, and we're going to talk about that. But Jesus talked about this, a spirit of affliction. A spirit of affliction. Do you know how rare it is to talk to a Christian that understands that there is actually there's a spirit of infirmity? Do you ever hear of a hypochondriac? You know what that is? That's a person who thinks about being sick all the time. They are expecting, their expectation is that they're going to be sick. And guess what happens? You get sick, because that's what you believe. You believe after a while, here's a scheme of the devil. I don't know how far I'm going to get with this. Doesn't matter to me. But here's what: when you have that belief system, that it becomes a demonic stronghold. Spirit of infirmity will all of a sudden be connected to your life. And if you don't know what you're dealing with, you can't come against it. Now, there's other people, it's not a spirit of infirmity. They're not dealing with sickness all the time. When you have a spirit of infirmity, it's like having a spirit of fear. Now, you recall, and it's in your notes, let's jump there, look at your notes, we'll do a little notes, right in front of the notes. These are 25 spirits that the Bible talks about. These are spiritual entities. If you don't know what you're dealing with, you will not have victory over it. When the Lord said in Hebrews 4:6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, that's what he meant. But if you have the knowledge, if you are not proactive in your faith. See, faith is an active verb. It's not just, a doctrine. Well, you get faith to be saved, yeah, and that's it. No. Zoe life, in other words, to be saved means to be whole. That's what it means. Just doesn't mean be saved in your spirit. Zoe life is you're saved and you're made whole. If you look up the term, the Greek term, it's you are made whole in your spirit, your soul, and your body. You're healed and healthy and whole in your spirit, in your mind, in your emotions, and physically. You're whole. That's what it means. You know, a lot of folks go, well, I don't know about that. Sickness is this, sickness is that, and everybody deals with it. Okay, if you believe that, that's the thing, that's going to unfold in your life. But Jesus said, by his stripes you are healed. Not could be, you're already healed. It's like salvation. If you talk to somebody who's not saved, are they really already saved? Yeah, they have to do is activate their, because their sins have been paid for, correct? They've been paid for. How do they get saved then? They have to have faith. It's by grace you're saved through faith. So that's how you get saved. Now, how do I? Healing is great. Divine health is better. Amen. And there's a lot to divine health, because it's not. It is spiritual, certainly, but it's a battle in the spirit realm. And if we're not proactive in the battle, then we're compromised. We're compromised and we're neglectful. But it's not only my spiritual faith, but it also impacts on divine order of my physical body. All as I need for this body to break down is neglected. Don't exercise. If you put too much weight on, it begins to affect everything. The whole body is affected by that. And I understand, in America, there's a struggle with that. But exercise and proper nourishment, it's like having a car. You put bad gas in it, guess what? Boom, 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 boom. Throw a little water in your gas. Boom, 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 boom. You throw some sugar in your gasoline tank. That doesn't boost your octane, honey. You got a problem there. So we have to take care of ourselves physically, spiritually, emotionally. Now, this is not just a message about healing, but it has to do with what we're dealing with in the spirit realm. And John wrote, he said, I would that you would prosper. I like that. That means succeed. I would that you would prosper and be in even as. Everybody say even as. See the connection? Even as your soul prospers. What's your soul? That's my emotions and my mind, my intellect, and my will. When I am at peace, when I have peace in my heart, and I am not embroiled emotionally, and I want to teach you a lot about about really how the enemy ultimately works, it's through the power of your emotions. When your emotions are overloaded or out of sync, and you lose your peace, that's where the enemy has access to your body, right there. John made the principle, I would you would prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. So when we are in divine order, both physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, then we can have the prospect of divine health, which is superior to divine healing. But should we have an infirmity, then we have divine healing by his stripes. He bore in his body, all of my infirmities and all of my diseases, right? So, but that is a battle that must be fought on a daily basis. And I've told you before, one of my daily prayer is to break curses, is to come against the enemy by the blood of the Lamb. Virtually every day, I pray over my body. I come in here, I anoint myself. I say, get the anointing on, anoint myself, and then I start at it. I say, I receive divine health from my brain, and my nervous system, my heart, my cardiovascular system, divinely anointed by God, touched by God, divine health. Thank you for that. And I go through the whole system, my bones, my muscles, my digestive system. My immune system. I just say, blessing the Lord, bless it, bless it, bless it. Then I go and I get the blood of Jesus as a weapon. You want to say a powerful weapon, and that most Christians don't even think about it. You don't mention it. Not you may. I don't know. I find it rare. That you get to the, you come before the Lord and speaking against the powers of darkness, and you begin to take that blood and use that as a weapon against the enemy. The devil is defeated by the blood of the Lamb. Do you know how small a percentage of preaching there is about the blood of Jesus in the church today? Watch a week of TV ministry, and I would say it would be rare for you to find a message preached about the blood of the Lamb. You know why? Because the devil shut that one down in a minute. Because there's power in the blood. We'll sing the song, but then we don't use the weapon. It's like having a sash of weapons, and you just don't take it, you just leave it in the sheath. You know, we've got the weapon here, there's a big sword up here. Well, that blood of the Lamb is like a huge weapon. Revelation 12, 10, and 11, it says that, you know, the devil comes and he accuses the people. He accuses the saints before God day and night. Why? He wants to disturb you. He's not going to bring some nice accusation against you. He's going to tell you what you're not, what you can't do, or what you do have, and it's not all, and none of it's good. He said, but we overcome him, Lucifer, Satan, the serpent, the dragon. We overcome him, Revelation 12, 11, we overcome him by the blood of the Lamb. By the what? The blood of the Lamb. And the word of their testimony. And they love not their life unto death. Now you think about that. And most of the messages that we, and you know, it's a broad spectrum of things that we learn in the kingdom, but we better learn this one, because if we don't have discernment in this, if we're not knowledgeable of how the enemy works, we'll just buy into the human program. Well, there's a flu going around, and you know, we're all going to get it, and you have a little symptom. You know, folks get a little symptom, physical symptom, and right away their testimony becomes, well, I think I got it. You know, everybody's getting it. And then you start right there. That devil puts a, say it. And thinking it's bad enough, when you begin to confess it, you just got in agreement with the powers of darkness. He says, got you right there. I got you. Now I got a stronghold in your life. And we don't, and the saints don't even know it. When Paul said, we're not ignorant of his devices, they weren't ignorant because they had to know it in the stuff that went on in their life. And you look at Paul and the stuff that went on in his life. It was no party at the beach. He said, we know how the enemy works. We know the people that he works through. They weren't fooled by anything. And their persecution just worked out to the glory of God some way. They're stuck in jail, whatever. This isn't a good opportunity for us to worship God. See, we're not ignorant of his devices. That's the greatest problem in the church today, is ignorance of the devices and the schemes of the evil one. So we just buckle under. There's no aggressive faith. There's no aggressive faith. Very little of it. I mean, going after the thing. I told you about Kathy having a problem at night. She had a struggle with something would come on her. She would lose consciousness. I said, what is that? And the Lord just made this very real. He said, I am the overseer of this home. I'm the spiritual covering here. See, you know, you could do this. You could run to the doctor and say, oh, let's do tests and let's do this and let's do that. And the Lord made it real. It's a spirit of infirmity comes upon her. Affects her body. So now, see, what's the plan? What's the strategy? To get up, when that thing comes on, I've got to pray over her. Pray over her, put the lights on, and then I pray in the spirit. And I pace up and down that bedroom. Jesus' name, Jesus' name. I take authority over you in the power of God. This is God's house. I'm the purveyor of this house. I'm the overseer of this house. And I pray and pray until it would subside and go to bed. And then over time, it'd come back again. I'm up. I'm in the lights on. I'm praying in the spirit. I'm praying with the understanding, taking authority over the powers of darkness. This is my house. You have no place. And no, don't touch my wife. Jesus' name. This is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Disease coming in? No, this is divine territory. Are you kidding me? Now, that's where I'm... That's what I do. That's where I live. So this is divine territory. You have no part in this temple. Disease? I don't think so. But that has to be an aggressive faith and a confidence. Say, no, you're not coming in there. But you have feel this. I don't care what I feel. I don't live by feelings. We live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. It's a device of the enemy. Why? To get you to buckle under. To just buy into it. I remember when I was teaching, and I understood these things, principles, way back, and I'd feel sick. Or my back was, I threw my back out at one point in time, and I just stay home. I said, I'm not staying home. I don't feel well. I'm going in. I'm not going to lay in that bed. I wouldn't lay in a bed and bring me pills and all this stuff. I said, well, I'm not laying in the bed. I'm going in to work. And I'll feel miserable. You know what? I said, in Jesus' name, that you lying devil, you cannot. And the more I did that, now I don't get sick anymore. But it took a while because I was getting sick at the beginning. Before I understood this, I'd get sick. And I began to pray this way. And I said, no, but it had to be, it was aggressive act of faith saying, and I'd go to war with the thing. And I claim that promise until I die. I said, that's my promise. And if there's a failing in it, it's not God's failing. It's not God's failing. We can say, I had a toothache. I believed God for that toothache until I was about done. Take me to the dentist. Hallelujah! Thank God for the dentist, and he pulled that thing out and put the Novocaine in it. See, I don't want you to make you feel bad, because there are some things that I still don't understand that, and I've seen some really godly people with a lot of faith still get some sickness in their body, and I don't understand that. I will not understand it. All I know is here's what God says, and I'm going to go with everything that lieth within me. And if there's some point, I don't expect it. If I get a tooth, then I got to go there. I don't have faith for teeth, I guess. I don't know. I don't get it. I have eyeglasses on. I could pray mine until Jesus comes back. Thank God for I got eyeglasses. I don't understand that. But I'm thankful for what I understand and what I do possess. And I want to get more of it. And I want to walk in that authority. And I want to walk in that power. So I think the most important thing to for you to understand is Ephesians 6, 11 and 12. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the what? The wiles, the schemes, the deceptions of the enemy. Because you know what? He wants you to live a miserable person. You go to heaven, you're saved, well, so I'm saved. He said, but between now and then, I want to absolutely rob your testimony. I want you to be miserable. I want you to be sick. I want you to be burned out. I want you to be emotional basket case. That's what I want for you. Why? Because it's about you. You know, it's not about you. It's about Jesus. He wants to rob the glory of Jesus right there. That's what he wants to do. Rob his glory. Because we've been born for the glory of God. What is the glory of God? We talked about it this morning at the men's meeting. Here's what the glory of God is. I learned it in Bible school. I went for one class. That was my Bible training. I was up at a leadership meeting up at the Bible school where I was a regional coordinator for Elam Fellowship of Churches and Ministers International. And I went up there for a meeting, a leadership meeting, and that was the evening, and I said, I don't have anything to do. Is there any? He said, well, there's a class going on. I said, I'll go down there. I'm going to just sit in the class. And Brother Edwards was preaching there that day. Great, great preacher. And I sat in there and he taught. There's one thing I got out of the class. How many know it's a good day when you get one thing out of a class? And he taught me about what the glory of God is. It says, the glory of God is when the thing created fulfills its destiny. When the thing created fulfills its destiny, it brings God glory. The heavens declare his glory. They were when they fulfill their destiny, when they're in the starry heavens and you look up and you say, glory to God. When you and I fulfill our destiny, when we're living with the peace of God and the fruits of the Spirit, when we've been saved, healed, and delivered, when our families are united, when there's the love of the brethren in the church and the brothers and sisters love one another, and there's peace and there's contentment and there's joy, the glory of God is manifested. And the devil comes, he says, I want to rob Jesus' glory. And I want to draw it to myself. And you know how he does it? He does it through division. He does it through emotional excess. He does it through anxiety and worry and fear. And go through the list. And that we're all burned out. Emotional basket cases. On a roller coaster. All sick. He said, well, that's nothing. And it doesn't mean we're not saved, and it doesn't mean Jesus doesn't love us. That's not the point. It's there's so much that we are not acquiring and living and fulfilling for the glory of God. Listening this morning, and I'll turn the TV pro, I do my research, and I'll turn on the religious programming. You know what? It's very rarely where you find that it's all about the glory of God. No, it's about what you get and how you can get things from God and how you can get the formulas down. And if you get the formula down, then you can get God to give you whatever you want. And you know, in the final analysis, that's what often it's about. I was listening to one fella, you know, the $1,000 seat is the big thing now, and you have to send the $1,000. Get your credit card right now, because God just spoke to me, and when you give me this $1,000, your miracles are coming, miracles, miracles, it's 72 hours, and the miracles are coming. And you have to give, because there's a special number, $1,129, because I found a scripture that says that. And that's the scripture, 129, so it's $1,129. And in 72 hours, it's coming in, and this is what happened to me, because I gave it over here, and I got $20,000 back. Go get your credit card right now. Don't give it any place else. This is what he said specifically. It's because the anointing's upon me, and if you give it, you have to give it to me, because it's my anointing, and you connect with my anointing. Mega church, and they're only still on that television because people are going to the phone with their credit card. Totally deceived, being manipulated by men. They're not God's servants. They're just making themselves wealthy. It's all works for them. Why? Because you're sending it to them, not you. Somebody is. And I'll give you three and four and five of them that are doing the same thing. So it's all about you and what you get at it and how you can get rich. For those of you who weren't here on Wednesday and did not hear the message by Paris Reedhead, 10 shekels in a shirt, and those who heard it said radical, unbelievably powerful, life-changing, dramatic message that God gave to that man, most powerful message ever preached. And we sat here on Wednesday, and you're just sitting there with your mouth open, change your life. I would like that message to be put on those television, put them all on television, that one man, that one message. But you know what? It'd empty the churches out. That's the problem. It'd empty the church. I've said to you probably more than a year now, I put a little flyer out there on the, and I put cards in there. I put about 5 or 6 cards in there, and I've said that is, do not neglect to sit down yourself, or you and your wife, turn everything off and sit in the presence of the God, pray, and listen to that message. It'll reorient your life and your thinking and your spiritual awareness of life. And all the cards are still out there. And I asked, has anybody? No. So we did listen to it on Wednesday, and very wonderful night of revelation comes. Because we got the thing off the rails, and it comes off the rails, a lot of it, through TV preaching. And I might add this, it's not all bad. Because there's a lot of good preachers on television, and I've heard some good ones. It's the imbalance, number one, or number two, it's the lack of certain information. Because if I preach here, and what you find in some churches, every Sunday you preach on salvation, salvation, everybody gets saved, salvation, and I preach another salvation, is it good preaching? Yeah, it's another good message I'm preaching. But guess what? This is a big Bible. It's got a lot of subjects in it. And you better preach the whole counsel of God, and one of them, and it's prolific throughout the scriptures, is dealing with the powers of darkness. Put on the whole armor of God. Why? Because you're dealing with an enemy that you're able to stand against the wiles, the schemes of the enemy. For we wrestle not. Question is, do we wrestle? Answer? Yes. Yeah. So you can't, you know, if somebody says, oh, you know, I'm just in the Lord and I'm just praising God and I've got the... No, you have no knowledge of the battle that you're in here. Now the good news is this, the battle has already been won. Amen. We covered that last week. Jesus led captivity captive, you know, spoiled principalities, powers, made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Wow. This morning at our new study was great, you know, that showed one of these, the Roman arcs, where they, who was it, Octavius Caesar, is one of these guys, had a victory, and they built this incredible arch. See how much we learned this morning. And they would then march the enemy all in chains, bound up, and they had pictures of the enemy over there, you know, all oppressed, you know, and defeated, right? And they'd march him through that arch and with the cheers of the people in that city. And that's what's being referenced here. That's Paul is writing, and that's what the concept is. He said that the enemy has been totally defeated. You just need to walk in that victory. But you got an enemy. And the greatest strategy of the enemy is to get you to neglect the idea of and the knowledge of the battle that's still raging around you. That you don't even know what's coming on. So he devises a scheme against you, and you buy into it. And you're influenced by it. And you're unaware of it. Book of Acts, here comes the woman behind Paul and Silas and them guys. These are the men of the Most High God. These are the men of the Most High God. Oh, wow. Ooh, glory. I'm better than the Most High God. Until it goes on a day, whatever it was, and then guess what happens? Paul turns around and says, in the name of Jesus, come out of her. It's a demon in her. Saying what? These are the men of the Most High God. See, if you do not have the gift of the Spirit, which is discernment, you have somebody come into your church giving you all accolades and the devil's in her. You got no discernment. And pretty soon you got a problem. You got something else right in the midst of it. Thank you for that. I didn't refer to it yet, but you're way ahead of me on that one. What is that? Check this out. That is Kali. Your question is?
Who is Kali?
Who is Kali? one of the fiercest of all the world's deities, a ferocious form of mother goddess. Often seen, if you go online, you see it, she often has a severed head. Does that remind you of anything? Has two heads on for earrings, a necklace of skulls, a girdle made of severed hands, and the tongue protruding, and is called the god of power and change and destruction. Now, I might say this, there is a new fad. It started back with a group called KISS. Do you remember that group? Guess what they would do? They would stick out there. It's a satanic gesture. Now, that's not one of those sticking out your tongue. This is when the tongue is out like in a grotesque figure. There's a young lady, pray for her, her name is Miley Cyrus. And she does the twerking and all, she didn't need a player. She was a fine young lady, I don't know too much, but she was in a program and now she's turned into this and she's does all of these programs and the big thing is she sticks her tongue away. I don't know how their tongue gets so large like that. But if you will go online and find and do a little research on that, that is a satanic gesture. Not all the time everybody sticks out their tongue. That's what that is. Now, here's what happened. Okay, here's what we're dealing with. The building that you're looking at there is the Empire State Building. Just prior to that, is that you, Jack?
I don't think so.
You don't think, okay. See, if it's for me, tell them I'll get back. Or if it's for you, tell them that you'll get back. The enemy comes, destroys the two towers. If you've listened to Jonathan Cahn and his message on the Harbinger in Judgment 9:10, you'll know a little bit about this. And that judgment came, and the nation for about 15 minutes got real spiritual, and everybody showed up at the churches. But then they went out and quoted Isaiah 9:10, which is a scripture of rebellion against God, and they didn't know it. And all of our leaders, the head of our government, used that particular verse is as their response to the destruction of the towers. And basically it says this, the towers have been destroyed, but we will, in our arrogance, we'll build another tower in its place because we're strong and we're not bowing down and we're not repenting. So they built another tower. And just recently, they put this figure, and I don't know who got it up there. Whenever you do not serve God and you drive God out of your nation, out of your culture, it will be replaced by another God. There will be another God worshipped. And the arrogance of whomever put that up there in one sense, now I don't know if they sit down and think about this, or it just comes out of the nature of rebellion, and it says, we offer our city to another God. Another God, a God of change, a God of destruction, and they broadcast it and they put it right in the center of the city. On that symbol of that state, but that city is the best, is the greatest state in America. That is our premier city, the Big Apple. And they're saying, we turn the thing over to Lucifer. We're not putting Jesus' picture up there. We're putting Kali's picture up there. The one who's got the seven severed head in her hands. The mother goddess of destruction. Ferocious. Now you think about that. The wiles of the enemy and what we'll be living in. And if you don't have discernment and you're just going along with some religious program, you wind up in a ditch. Because the Bible says in the last days they will heap to themselves teachers who will just simply tickle their ears. And that's how they want it. Don't want to hear anything challenging. Don't want to hear about spiritual warfare. Just tell us something good. We studied the 12 minor prophets. And the prophet would come, and then of course Jeremiah was famous for this. He had a message of, and he said, you know, to bring the church back, to God's people back. And he says, you're backslidden, you need to repent of your sins. And the king would say, get that guy out of here. I know every time he shows up, them Ezekiels, them Jeremiahs, Every time they come, they're always saying something bad about me, always challenging me. Bring me one of those other prophets who say something nice to me. And they line them up. Thus saith the Lord, everything is good, and you're wonderful. You're just a man of God, and you're this. Thank you. Okay, I'm good now. They're not heed the word, a prophetic word from God. I don't know when I'm going to do this. I'm just praying about it, but I've got a word that will absolutely, it will radically, again, go to the base of your spiritual life. If I could just know when to do it. I don't know when to do it. Jonathan Kahn preached a message just recently, October 25th, and I just happened to find it. And I'll tell you what, you want to hear a prophet? You want to hear a prophet? Ready to hear a prophet? He preaches a message, and he deals with this stuff, that Shemitah year and all that kind of stuff. God sent America a prophet. Guess what? He's a Jewish guy. He's a Jewish guy. Looks like a Jew. He looks Jewish. He said, I'm going to have him explain it to you. He's a prophet to America. And he preached this message, I'm telling you. He showed this picture, by the way, which Laura had sent to me prior to that. I said, God, I got to show it to you. I said, check this out. Empire State Building, they put that on the side? You got to be kidding me. What in the world? Where have we come? Where are we going? Isn't there no righteous voice in the land? Isn't there no herald? Is no one to blow the trumpet in Zion? Sound the alarm on my holy mountain? Rare. You know what they want? Your $1,000 seed. Send me your $1,000 seed so God will give you this 72 hours. Oh, miracles, it's going to... Yeah, right. You got no discernment. They line up to send them that guy that money. And it's not one. They got a handful of them. You know what it's rooted in? If you were here Wednesday night, the end of all being is the happiness of man. That's what it is. All of this whole thing, everything's about your happiness. And God is up there to serve you. And Jesus is your little genie. And I'll teach you how to get the principle. And then you just got to rub your little Bible there and get the principle. And Jesus will pop out and give you whatever you want. I said, that message is not from heaven. And I'll tell you what, they'll weave truth into it. That's how you get you. Because the most sinister lie is the one that's woven into some truth. Remember, Jesus met the Lucifer in the wilderness, right? Guess what? He quoted the word out of context. Oh, the word says, if you jump off the thing here, the angels will bear you up. Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. That's how we'll get you. You know why? Because people don't know what's in the book. How can you be deceived? Very easily. Don't know what's in the book. Discernment comes by the Spirit, but it is connected to the truth of this Bible. So what's a device of the enemy? Here's a device of the enemy: to keep you out of the book. To stick you in front of a television for umpteen hours and you got no Bible in you. John 6:63 says, my word is spirit and it's life. How are you going to fight the battle? You don't know the word. Something happens in your life, you got nothing. You got no sword, you got nothing. What are you going to fight with? This will be more and more an aggressive army moving forth in the power of God. And the glory of God is going to come upon that church that lives for the glory of God. When we embrace this central philosophy of our life, the end of all being is the glory of God. Everything I do, everything I am, every place I go, whatever I do is for the glory of God. The byproduct is, yes, you will have happiness, you have a happy life. You'll have the joy of the Lord, and you have a bunch of good things, but it's not the prime product, it's the byproduct. The prime product is this, for the glory of God. Why do I want my marriage to be so successful? I have him in the counseling clinic. I said, why did you come here to get to do this? Why did you come? You know what it comes down to? I'm not happy. You fix this so I can get happy. Fix him. Fix him up. Get him happy. Make him right so that I want to be happy. And she's the same way. I said, it'll never work for you. Oh, it'll work. It'll work for 2 weeks, maybe a month, and then you'll be back at it because you won't be happy. That guy can't make you happy, ultimately. Because guess what? He ain't God. And she can't make you happy because she's not God. And it's not about happiness anyway. It's about joy, because happiness depends on happenings. Correct? I got to plan something else to get happy. I said, until you come to this conclusion that you're coming here that God may be glorified in this marriage relationship, simply because the marriage relationship of a godly man and a godly woman is ground zero for the manifestation of the glory of God. When the thing created, marriage, fulfills its divine destiny of unity and love, and it finds expression in the earth, you are now bringing glory to God. And you know what the demon said? I'll not have it so. I'll bring you down into division and derision and anger, and I'll empower your emotions with hatred. I had a woman in there, I've been counseling this couple. And between the two of them, they're just not listening. And I finally get them back in there. She says, you know what? I hate them. She said, I'll leave them in a minute except for these children. She said, I hate them. So those circumstances, that man has got that woman to the place where her emotions have bound her up, because that's where you get bound up. Go through the list. It's fear, spirit of anger, spirit of bitterness. See, goes on. Hatred. Now he's got you. He's got you. He said, I can use you to bring chaos in this home. And God will never be glorified in it. Never be glorified in it. I said, until you come to the conclusion, until you say, we will do this for the glory of God. It's not about my happiness, not about your happiness. This is for the glory of God. That is my prime motive. And out of that will come a joy and a peace and a love and a contentment. And we'll enjoy life. That will be the byproduct, not the prime product. You listen to TV over and over again, those religious programs, almost to a session. It will be about your happiness. That's what it'll be about. They may throw in a verse here or there about the glory of God, but at the end of the guy preached this morning, he got 10 minutes on how to be saved, and then the next 40 minutes was about the $1,000 seed offering, get to the phone. Take some time, as we end, to go down through these principalities and powers. Bring the notes back. We're going to go through this some more, all right? No time to get to some of these other... Just, if you don't have this handout on how to fight by the blood of the Lamb, I will embellish this and give you some more instruction on it. I've taught about it on occasion, but I need to talk about it again and again and again until you actually do this. I won't say how many people pray. I pray this every time I pray. I take authority over every curse. We're going to talk about how to break these curses. So I break blood of the Lamb. Seven places where Jesus shed his blood. I say I take authority over that devil in Jesus' name. And I go through every one of those areas. And blood of Jesus. Blood of Jesus. Proactive. Right? Hallelujah. Let's pray. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for this time to study your word and to hear from heaven. Lord, I pray that your word would go forth in power here or wherever you would broadcast it, Lord. That, Lord, those who hear would be inspired, Lord, to seek after you, to go into your word, to live as men who are righteous, women who are righteous, who will not succumb to the deceptions of the enemy, that they would walk in the power of the Spirit, clad in the armor of God, wielding the weapons of warfare, the sword of the Spirit, the word of God that is two-edged, dividing the soul from the spirit, the shield of faith, marching into battle. Lord, that we would be, as it were, proactive, that we would be aggressive in our faith. Not so we would be happy, but that you would be glorified. And we thank you for that in the name of Jesus. Everybody said amen. 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 Hallelujah. Let's all stand. Thank you, Dan. Put something on. Put that song on, brother, that I showed you, We Will Reign, whatever that one is. Chris Tomlin does a great job on that. Just close your eyes for a moment. Lord, do a work here. Walk in your power.
In the bleak midwinter, all creation grows. And for a world in darkness, frozen like a stone, light is breaking in a stable for a throne.
Thank you.
And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And
he shall reign forevermore. And Lord, we're going to rule and reign with you. Lord, may it start right now. We're not waiting to get to the millennium to rule and reign, Lord, but we rule and reign now. Hallelujah. Spirit of God, just come in power into this place, Lord, that you would raise up a mighty army, Lord, men and women who walk in victory. As we follow the great Commander-in-Chief, our great King, the victorious one. And we walk in his victory and in his power to bind every demon of darkness that holds back this church and these people. Every spirit of fear, lying, haughtiness, perversion, heaviness, hopeless despair, we bind it. Spirits of infirmity, your power is broken. Every bondage, spirit of slumber, every seducing spirit is bound. Spirit of error, bound by the blood of the Lamb, by the blood of the Lamb, by the blood of the Lamb. Loose your hold off of these people. We declare victory. In the name that's above every name, in the name of Jesus, we say he is King. And we live for his glory. Hallelujah. We live for the glory of God. Thank you, Lord, that you're doing a great work in this place. And we honor you in it, Lord, because we know the victory comes from you. In the glorious name of the Lord. Hallelujah. And everybody shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace in that great name. Hallelujah. Now, if you need prayer, come on up. We're going to pray for you. Evermore.